In the autumn of 1942, only the grim resistance of the Red Army stood between Hitler and the conquest of the city which he sought above all others, Stalingrad. The terrible ferocity of the fighting in the ruined city has become a byword for savagery and human suffering. The dramatic events which were played out on the Russian front during the titanic struggle between Hitler and Stalin reached a peak of intensity and decisiveness here at Stalingrad.
For the sheer depth of savagery and the appalling nature of the fighting at Stalingrad, it's almost impossible to find a parallel, because this fighting was so intense, so protracted, and also it took place under the worst imaginable conditions. It took place in the depths of a Russian winter.
They did not fear dishonor. They did not fear death, because they had already been to hell.
Schlimm war es für die Jungen und die aus der Heimat dann als Ersatz kamen, die von gleich von Anfang an in irgendeinen grausamen Angriff oder in einer grausamen Verteidigung reinkamen. Also wir konnten die alle abschreiben. Ne?
It was the first major, unmistakable defeat of German forces in the Second World War. A whole army was destroyed, a quarter of a million men. It is inescapably a major reverse.
The first year of the titanic struggle between Hitler and Stalin had been a successful year for the German army by any standards. Although they'd not captured Moscow or Leningrad, German armies stood at the gates of both of those cities. They still held the strategic initiative and could choose to strike at either of Russia's great cities. The world waited with bated breath.
Hitler certainly held all the aces in early 1942. I think the world, and probably Stalin, expected him to try and deliver a knockout blow against Moscow. Alternatively, you could be forgiven for expecting him to try and end the protracted siege of Leningrad. But what he actually did was to very cleverly shift the whole strategic focus of the campaign onto the war in the south.
German commanders tended to look towards the southern area of the Soviet Union with its oil reserves, its economic resources and its agricultural riches.
Germany didn't quite have enough oil, it only really had the Romanian oil fields to draw on. That would help the German war effort, and above all it would deprive the Russians of their valuable source of oil. So it was a very well thought out strategy, and it certainly wrong-footed Stalin. What it did, however, was to stretch the German forces well beyond the limits of their capabilities.
For the summer campaign of 1942, codenamed Operation Blue, Army Group South, now under the command of Fedor von Bock, was strongly reinforced so that almost half of the entire German armed forces in Russia were concentrated in the southern sector. The vast army group which was now assembled was so huge that command was split into two separate subgroups, named Army Group A and Army Group B. Army Group A, under Field Marshal List, was to attack into the Caucasus Mountains and to capture the precious oil fields which Germany desperately required in order to sustain her war effort. Army Group B, now under the command of Field Marshal von Weichs, was to drive from Kharkov in the direction of Stalingrad, a name that was to be burned into the pages of history. The task of capturing the city which bore Stalin's name fell to two principal German formations, the 6th Army and the 4th Panzer Army. They were supported by a mixture of Romanian, Hungarian, and even Italian allies. Although many of the Allied formations would fight with courage and tenacity, they suffered from a lack of training and heavy equipment.
There's been a historical tendency to blame the Romanian formations for all the ills that the German army suffered on the southern area of the front. That the Romanian armies were of inferior quality to their German counterparts.
By comparison, the German 6th Army, which provided the main thrust on Stalingrad, was a highly efficient military machine. but it was a name which was to be remembered for all the wrong reasons, along with the name of its new and inexperienced commander, General Friedrich Paulus.
Paulus was a very good staff officer with excellent social skills. He was not a commander of large formations. He had never commanded a division. He had never commanded a corps. And he would not, in the ordinary course of events, have seemed a likely candidate to command 6th Army, which was a huge organization.
It was only the unfortunate heart attack suffered by his predecessor, Reichenau, that suddenly catapulted Paulus into this new and exalted position.
So now Paulus, the man who was supposed to be an excellent office manager for the military genius, Reichenau, is the man in charge.
It is no exaggeration to say that the outcome of World War II was decided here, in the smoking ruins of the streets of the shattered city. The name of Paulus is irrevocably tied to the tragedy of Stalingrad. Tantalizingly, the Germans had almost succeeded in capturing the city without the need to resort to street fighting. Paulus hesitated for 2 vital days.
The German 6th Army could conceivably have won at Stalingrad, but only under one condition. That is, before or by September the 13th, 1942, they had managed to encircle outside the city of Stalingrad the 2 Soviet armies which subsequently defended the city, namely the 62nd Soviet Army and the 64th Soviet Army.
People were making mistakes on the ground, and the prime mistake among those is Paulus. What he does towards the end of August is to rest and regroup and gather his strength before he drives south to join with the 4th Panzer Army. His headquarters, Army Group B, were urging him to move south, and for 2 vital days he delays his movement to the south, and that allows the Russian armies to escape the German pincers and get back into Stalingrad.
But Paulus's army is not a rock and roll armored formation. He's not got fast logistics. He's not got personnel carriers. His army advances on foot. Its logistics advance in horse and cart. He's only got 1 low capacity railway line to support his advance.
Hoch zu Ross geht es an die Maschinen.
The stage was now set for one of history's most cataclysmic battles. Before the ground fighting could intensify, the Luftwaffe took a hand in the proceedings. It was to prove a disastrous intervention. In order to blast the will of the defenders to resist and save German lives in the coming battle, more than 600 aircraft of the 8th Air Corps launched a series of devastating raids against the city. Unfortunately, the bombs of the Luftwaffe did little to break the will of the defenders.
Wolfram von Richthofen, who was the commander of the 4th Air Fleet, had a very poor view of the fighting on the ground. He felt that the soldiers of the 6th Army weren't doing enough to prosecute the capture of the city. And his answer was to demonstrate what effective and skilled leadership could produce in the terms of the application of force. So he orders the 4th Air Fleet to pound Stalingrad into rubble.
In the past, Hitler had had tremendous success launching huge terror bombing raids against enemy cities. And generally, when you do that, they give up.
In Stalingrad, what that does is it creates this wilderness of rubble and gives the defenders of Stalingrad the chance to turn it into what essentially became a fortress.
Throughout the autumn of 1942, the German 6th Army slowly ground its way towards the capture of Stalingrad. The ruins of the city soon gained the nickname of the Minzer, from the appalling casualties which resulted from the terrible fighting which took place from house to house and even raged in the sewers of the devastated city. The names of the principal factories and city landmarks now enjoy an eerie resonance in military history. The tractor factory, the barricade's arms plant. The Red October steelworks. The Lazur chemical plant. The strategic hill at Mumayev Kurgan. And the two railway stations are all synonymous with the unspeakable horrors which unfolded during this most bitter of battles.
When the Germans made the decision to go into the town center in Stalingrad, to actually go into town, they were accepting that they were going to get involved in street-to-street fighting. This is something they always avoided. The Germans did not want to get involved in street-to-street fighting because it did not allow them to use their natural advantages.
This was an army that was trained and motivated to take part in a mobile war, and suddenly they're pitched into this human mincer that Stalingrad has become.
Men were fighting from room to room in multi-story buildings. They were fighting at the top and the bottom of granary silos. They were fighting across and along the great big tractor factories in Stalingrad.
But it became invested with enormous psychological significance. Both sides really in this ghastly chest-to-chest struggle from which they couldn't be unlocked.
It was barbaric, it was implacable. It was fought in the sewers beneath the city. People were fighting in human excrement with flamethrowers and hand-to-hand. They were desperate to control a single room of an apartment block.
Despite heroic Russian resistance, by early October, the Germans occupied 70% of the city of Stalingrad. By the end of the month, the Russian 62nd Army, under its newly appointed commander, General V.I. Chuikov, was penned back against the Volga River. However, battered ferries from the Russian-held East Bank, running a gauntlet of bombs and artillery fire, kept the encircled defenders' lifeline in place. The heroic men of the Red Army were supplied with just enough food and munitions to maintain their fighting ability. Nonetheless, in the third week of October, it seemed as if the Russians would finally be overrun. With German troops only yards from the bank of the Volga, only the inspirational leadership of Chuikov, who rallied his forces in person from the thick of the action, saved the situation. Once again, the Red Army's incredible capacity to rally and regain the strong points they had lost prevented the fall of the city.
I think many commanders would have taken the logical decision to control the battle from the east bank of the Volga, where they could have a clearer idea of the fighting and be able to direct the battle effectively. Paulus, for example, was 15 miles away with his base at the airfield. That's not a question of cowardice, that's his job. He's keeping an eye on the entire extent of the battlefield, and he's in a position where he can direct operations. But Chuikov understands just how essential it is in this particular circumstance that he's actually seen to be there with his men.
He is committing himself to Stalin's order, not a step back, ni shagu nazad. And he is personifying the Soviet will to stand and fight at Stalingrad. So he's providing an excellent example to the Soviet soldiers.
For 2 months, the Sixth Army had been grinding its way towards capturing the city. Now, they had almost succeeded. By early November, the relentless and bloody fighting had led to the capture of 90% of the now ruined city.
The final stages of the German attack in November had driven Marshal Chuikov right down to the water's edge. And he had his headquarters, actually, on the water's edge between November the 24th and the last week, yes, of November. Running into the first few days of December, it appeared to be touch and go.
The conditions in Stalingrad were now unbelievably ghastly. This was a complete orgy of horror. The city, already reduced to rubble by the bombing, was now torn apart by new fighting by day and by night. Stalingrad was the scene of constant, uninterrupted shelling from heavy artillery of both sides, mortars, grenades, small arms fire, and the terrifying sound of hand-to-hand fighting. It was no longer a question of controlling an apartment block, but sections of the house, with every inch of open ground covered by snipers who fought their own deadly duels in the smoking ruins.
The famous sniper duels which were fought out in the ruins of Stalingrad are almost a novel in their own rights. There was even a famous woman sniper, Tanya Chernova, who claimed a great number of victims. But the most famous of all is Vasily Zaitsev, who is credited with having shot 500 individual German soldiers. So that's a big contribution for one man to make to a battlefield.
The Germans pride themselves on their tactical excellence, and the idea of some Soviet snipers unseen killing the Germans and the Germans not being able to respond in kind gets the Germans really bent out of shape. So the Germans send the brigadier who commanded the German sniper school at Zossen, a fellow named of Standartenführer SS Torwald, out to Stalingrad to try to redress the balance. The greatest heroic sniper in the German armed forces is going to go out there and he is going to see the whole thing straight. And Torwald gets out there and he does a lot of damage. He's an excellent sniper. And a group of Soviet snipers hunt Torwald down and kill him like a dog. The sniping was constantly to the Soviet advantage because the Soviets were the defenders.
The fighting at Stalingrad is generally regarded as one of the most notorious battles for its ferocity, its inhumanity, and for the conditions which grew more nightmarish as autumn gave way to winter. To add to the inhuman demands of the fighting, nature now added her own burden. The Russian winter descended.
The German army was never as well prepared for winter as the Soviet army. Russian winters suit Russian soldiers because they know how to deal with it. It's their home territory. They have got thick wool overcoats. They've got hats with ear flaps. They've got thick felt boots that enable them to not freeze solid to the ground when they walk. The Germans had none of this. The Germans were wearing leather-soled boots that transmit the cold up through the ground and suck all your heat right down through your shoes. They had machinery that was manufactured to sensitive tolerances that was not capable of dealing with the cold. They had to build fires under their vehicles to keep them from freezing up. They were not at all prepared from an equipment point of view to deal with a Russian winter.
After months of bloody house-to-house fighting of unimaginable horror, a new German attack was planned for November the 18th, but it was already too late. Behind the Russian lines, preparations were already underway for a counter-offensive to be launched on the 19th of November, which would doom the 6th Army's effort and spell the collapse of the whole German campaign in the south. North of Stalingrad, the situation was even more alarming. The great bend of the River Don was held by a mixture of Romanian, Italian, and Hungarian forces.
The Hungarians and the Romanians are traditional enemies. So it's not a very auspicious start from the first place to have two ethnic groups who can't stand the sight of each other. So the only thing the Germans could think of to do was to insert the Italian 8th Army into the line. So you had Hungarians, then Italians, then Romanians. So effectively what you've got is an army in form of the Italians who don't really want to be there, who are poor quality and very under-motivated in among two sets of troops who can fight quite well, but who hate each other. It's not a very good situation, and it was perfectly obvious to many in the German high command that there was a potential disaster looming there.
Not only did Hitler ignore the warnings of his generals, which grew more raucous as the campaign developed, but he continuously weakened the flanks of the two groups by siphoning off forces to feed his ongoing obsession with capturing the city named after his deadly rival.
What that meant in a broader sense was that the Germans spent tremendous time, effort, thousands of lives wedging themselves into this little hole on the bank of the River Volga. They bury themselves in Stalingrad. So yes, the Germans control most of the town, but what they've achieved thereby is trapping the single largest concentration of German combat power on the Eastern Front in one little town. So they've managed to do the Soviets' work for them. It is very heroic in the sense of individuals, and the German army functioned very well as they clawed their way in there. But in the big picture, they have rendered themselves useless.
Although the Red Army was holding on by its fingertips in the city itself, Soviet intelligence was well aware that the German army was being pushed to the very limits of its strength. Behind the Russian lines, the industrial capacity of the mighty Soviet Union was at last producing tanks and guns in the quantities needed. Vast reserves of manpower could still be tapped, and a massive counterstroke was at last a possibility.
Germans depended for victory on quality rather than quantity. They hoped always to use superior initiative, superior techniques, superior equipment, superior motivation, and pit that against the mass quantities of their enemies. There's an old communist saying, though, quantity has a quality all its own. And the Russians have got so many people, so many resources, they are able to produce 4 or 5 tanks for every one the Germans destroy. And as a result, you can't beat the Russians, not by just using quality.
Worst of all, the Germans are fighting this battle at the end of a supply line which is 1,200 miles in length. Every single bullet, every single gun, every single piece of food has to be brought 1,200 miles from Berlin to Stalingrad, and that's the reason for the impending disaster.
The Soviet High Command saw with a keen eye that both sides of the thinly stretched line to the north and south of Stalingrad were held by low-quality Romanian, Hungarian, and Italian troops. It was upon these divisions that the great Russian counterattack would break. Many of the German High Command were aware of the dangers, and Zeitzler, the chief of staff, actually flew to Hitler's headquarters in order to plead for permission for a withdrawal before the coming Soviet offensive had even begun. But Hitler was emphatic. He refused to move his troops from the Volga, and the rest is history.
The Soviet counter-offensive, which opened on the 19th November 1942, came as a huge and catastrophic surprise to the Germans. There had been hints. They suspected that something was going on, but they didn't realize the scale of what was going to happen. The first thing that happened was, that is, to the north of the Don, to the north of Stalingrad, several Soviet armies, including a tank army, fell on the German flank. But it wasn't a German flank. It was a flank manned by the Romanian army. And at sight of this Russian advance, the Romanians broke and fled. Down to the south of Stalingrad, a second pincer movement then began, in equal strength and in equal force. So the Germans discovered, actually, that they were really fighting on virtually on two fronts, to the north and the south. They had very rapidly to try and organize a defense, which was extremely difficult under the conditions. They had to try and, if you like, stabilize the area of the front which the Romanians were supposed to hold but which weren't holding. They then discovered that they themselves were in the middle of a huge and a gigantic trap. It wasn't just a few kilometers. It was extending several scores of miles. This came as a very great surprise to the German command. And it was really the weight, the speed, and the ferocity of the Soviet counteroffensive which really took them by surprise. This was no little local counterattack. It was a counteroffensive on a major scale.
On November the 22nd, the two Russian armies met, and Stalingrad was encircled. The hunters had now become the hunted, and an urgent race against time began. Even the inexperienced General Paulus requested that he be allowed to reform his troops and withdraw. Herr Sennenberg had good reason to thank his guardian angel that day. He was actually on board a troop train headed for Stalingrad, which was halted on the journey, which would have carried him to his death.
Nun fuhren wir Mitte November 42 fuhren wir per Bahn dann immer weiter nach Osten und kamen am 22. November, muss es gewesen sein, in Kalac an. Kalac ist eine Stadt am Don. Das liegt nur wenige Kilometer zum Wolga-Knie bzw. nach Stalingrad. Da wurden wir, das war der letzte Bahnhof vor Stalingrad. Jetzt sollten wir in Kalac ausgeladen werden. Aber als wir ausgeladen wurden, da schossen die Russen schon auf den Bahnhof von Kalac. Das kam uns unmöglich vor. Und wir dann raus, haben immer wieder Deckung gesucht, weil Granateinschläge waren. Und in einigen Stunden haben die Russen den Kessel um Stalingrad dicht gemacht. Und an uns vorbei strömten massenweise italienische und rumänische Truppen. Und in deren Abschnitten waren die Russen auch durchgebrochen und hatten den Kessel bei denen, den Stalingrad-Kessel, dicht gemacht.
During those first days of the encirclement, 300,000 men of the 6th Army, holding out in a pocket 20 by 30 miles, had barely 6 days' rations of food and ammunition for only 2 days of serious fighting. Ominously, it was noted that many of its artillery batteries were already completely out of shells. Hope of salvation for the German 6th Army rested on a rapid and speedy breakout before the Russian siege lines could take shape. There are many convincing arguments to suggest that had they seized the initiative, they would have escaped from the thinly held Soviet line of encirclement. On the 25th of November, again, Paulus urgently requested permission to begin the breakout. Many of the more pragmatic officers began to prepare their men for the obvious course of action, a breakout to the southwest to link up with the nearest German forces. When the reply was received from Hitler's headquarters, it was greeted with disbelief. The Führer's orders were to move back into Stalingrad, where the army was to form itself into a fortress garrison and await relief.
Merely giving Stalingrad the title of Fortress Stalingrad didn't transform it into one. What you had at best was a thinly held line of infantry in foxholes, and it was never going to be enough to hold the pocket against the superior Russian forces outside.
With the benefit of hindsight, it is obvious that once the chance to escape was missed, the 6th Army was inescapably doomed. At the time, however, many of the officers and men still held an unshakable belief in the powers of Adolf Hitler. On the 26th of November, Hitler delivered a personal message to the beleaguered troops of Stalingrad, ordering them to stand fast and promising to do all in his power to support them. The problem of supplies was turned over to the Luftwaffe, which had so efficiently supplied the pocket of Demyansk the previous spring.
At Demyansk, a German corps, which had been cut off by the Soviets, was successfully supplied from the air by the Luftwaffe. And Hermann Göring, the commander of the Luftwaffe, thought this was so good that when the 6th Army was cut off in Stalingrad, Göring went to Hitler and said, "I can supply it. There's no need to back off from Stalingrad. I will use the Air Force to supply Stalingrad."
But what happens at Stalingrad is we've got 300,000 men who are much further away from the German lines and who are facing a much better equipped, better organised and more experienced opponent. So although there are some parallels between Demyansk and Stalingrad, the sheer number of troops involved, 300,000, made it impossible to supply those men with the food and the ammunition that they required, with the consequence that this army was always going to starve.
Hermann Göring immediately agreed to fly in 550 tons of supplies per day. Despite the skepticism of the army's chiefs of staff, the airlift began on the 25th of November. The results of the first days of the operation were ominous for the troops still fighting the rats' war among the cellars and ruins of the city. Only 140 tons were delivered on day one, The same quantities arrived on day two, and on the third day, no supplies whatsoever reached the desperate German forces. Only two landing strips were available in the pocket at Stalingrad. Both were about 15 miles from the city. The exposed nature of the two fields at Gumrak and Pitomnik meant that the Luftwaffe had no safe landing grounds in the vicinity of the Sixth Army. As the German perimeter of control around the city shrank under Russian pressure, this situation consistently deteriorated. Thick fogs made flying hazardous, if not impossible. Freezing temperatures meant that aircraft servicing became a tortuous task for the German mechanics. Added to this, the Red Air Force was increasing its sorties and the tactics of its pilots were sharpening as the conflict wore on. Nearly 500 of the lumbering German transport aircraft were shot down in the doomed attempt to keep the garrison supplied. The airlift proved a fiasco, and the German troops soon began to starve. However, the airlift was only part of Hitler's strategy to relieve the situation in Stalingrad. Von Manstein was ordered to form a new army group, Army Group Don. This scratch formation included the 6th Army and the elements of the 4th Panzer Army, which were also trapped at Stalingrad. Outside of the Russian siege lines, the relief force was made up of those parts of the 4th Panzer Army not trapped inside the ring at Stalingrad, supported by the remnants of the badly mauled Romanian forces. Despite the fact that this force was obviously too weak for the task, something had to be attempted. The orders issued to General Hoth in charge of the 4th Panzer Army were to bring the enemy attacks to a standstill and recapture the positions previously occupied. The other element of von Manstein's strategy involved an attack by the mobile elements of the beleaguered 6th Army, who were ordered to break out westwards to meet the advancing 4th Panzer Army. When both assault forces met, they would provide a corridor through which the remnants of the 6th Army, still engaged in Stalingrad, could be withdrawn. Von Manstein's problems began even before his forces could attack the Russians. The reinforcements, which would give Army Group Don its only hope against vastly superior Russian numbers, failed to arrive. Worse, the Russian strength in the area was increasing. The 4th Panzer Army was forced to launch the offensive alone. Against all odds, by the 17th of December, Hoth's panzers had reached a position only 35 miles short of Stalingrad. Their presence had already forced sections of the Red Army surrounding the city to break away from the siege to block the advance. By the 19th of December, the relief force had gained another 5 miles and was just 30 miles from making contact with 6th Army. Inside the pocket, encouraging rumors spread among the trapped army that help was at hand. Men, weakened by hunger and weeks of constant fighting, gained a new will to resist. They held on, doggedly straining their senses for the first signs of Hoth's relieving panzers.
By mid-December, the River Volga had frozen solid, so that the Russians could build a road across it. So by mid-December, the Russians are able to supply their forces in Stalingrad with food, with fuel to keep warm, with ammunition to keep fighting. By mid-December, the Germans are cut off from most of their supplies, and as a result, each soldier is living on a couple of ounces of bread and half an ounce of sugar a day. And that is not enough to stay healthy. At that level of consumption, the human body becomes very vulnerable to disease. And under those conditions of extreme cold, frostbite is another serious threat. The Germans are dying mysteriously of some ailment that the German doctors don't understand. Well, they don't understand because it's starvation. That people are eating so little that they have no resistance to disease, so they've got typhus, they've got diphtheria, They are covered in lice. The surgeons have to use a spatula to scrape lice off of German soldiers before they can operate.
Von Manstein urgently requested Hitler to allow the Sixth Army to retreat towards him and bring the Russians under fire from the east and west. Once the German forces met, then the 3,000 tons of supplies assembled behind the 4th Panzer Army could be pushed through to those retreating from the city. It would be a desperate gamble for the 6th Army. Only 100 of its tanks remained operational, and these held sufficient fuel for a journey of 20 miles or less. The physical ability of the half-starved troops under Paulus to mount any sort of mobile campaign was also questionable. Faced with these risks, and in possession of previous orders from Hitler to stand firm, Paulus did not attempt to break out. He doomed the majority of the 250,000 soldiers under his command to slow and painful death.
Manstein, in his own memories, went to great lengths to suggest that Paulus had the option to break out from the pocket and hadn't taken it. In reality, Manstein had ordered Operation Winter Storm, which was intended to be a relief operation. It was intended to get to the pocket and resupply the pocket. The actual breakout from the pocket would have been codenamed Operation Thunderclap, and Paulus was briefed to break out on receipt of the codename Thunderclap. Now, Manstein never actually issued that codename, so I think it's very unfair to suggest, as is frequently done, that Paulus had freedom of movement. Hitler had absolutely given him a categoric assurance that he didn't have freedom of movement, that he had to stay on the Volga. And for Manstein to try and suggest that somehow it was Paulus's fault isn't very fair. He certainly didn't have a direct order from his superiors to do that. And those kind of men in that tradition were very much men who did things by the book. That was what had kept the German army functioning. That is what had got them all of the gains so far.
By the new year, Army Group Don, having abandoned the 6th Army to its fate, had withdrawn as far as Rostov.
One of the great arguments about, indeed one of the arguments at the time, for the so-called sacrifice of Paulus's 6th Army in Stalingrad, that in fact it was doing something very noble and very important. In other words, it was actually holding back Soviet forces so they would not be able to advance further and cut off the other German army group, which was operating in the Caucasus. In other words, it allowed the German armies which were in the Caucasus time to withdraw, time to fall back, time to escape an even bigger Soviet trap. That has a certain amount of force to it. That is perfectly true in the first part of the encirclement operation. But as time went on, and certainly by, let us say, mid-December, this argument had less and less force. First of all, because the Russians realized, from their point of view, they needed less troops to contain Stalingrad, and therefore troops are actually being released. And the second thing, the Russians were also developing plans themselves for a gigantic, a much huger encirclement operation.
As the thermometer plunged, frostbite became as big a killer as the Russians. On Christmas Day alone, 1,500 Germans died from frostbite and exposure. Despite the fact that Army Group A had successfully completed its withdrawal by early January, for the miserable defenders of Stalingrad, the nightmare went on and on.
One thing the bombing raid does is it ensures that nothing is left in Stalingrad that is flammable. Because so many of the German bombs were incendiary bombs, because the city of Stalingrad catches fire and every wooden dwelling in Stalingrad burns. A few months later, when the Germans are sitting in Stalingrad and they've got no fuel and it's winter and they want to keep warm, there is nothing left for them to burn.
I think it's one of the enduring legends of military history, how these men were able to keep going, to keep fighting under these appalling conditions of starvation, of the worst imaginable Russian winter, with superior forces all around them, and essentially their hope gone as well, because by this stage the word had gone round the army that there was no real prospect of Hoth coming to their rescue. So it's superhuman courage, it's the will to live, it's the will to keep going when in the face of despair when hope's gone. So it's something that, fortunately, in our own comfortable lives, we've never had to experience, but there was a phenomenon that somehow kept these men on their feet and going, and I think it's probably the sheer will to survive.
By the end of January, the Germans are finally beginning to desert. They are no longer afraid of desertion because death is preferable to living in Stalingrad. So even if they're shot while surrendering by the Soviets, it's not at all a scary thought anymore. They did not fear dishonor. They did not fear death because they'd already been to hell.
The ordinary German soldiers only gradually became aware of the magnitude of the disaster which was upon them. As the perimeter shrank, the airstrips were lost to the advancing Russian forces. Once again, Herr Sennenberg had cause to thank the gods of war for a second personal deliverance.
Jetzt war es so eines Tages, da sagte man uns, ihr werdet jetzt eingeflogen, ihr werdet nach Stalingrad eingeflogen. Und wir wurden in Marsch gesetzt zu einem sogenannten Stukahafen. Und von da ab sollten dann Transportflugzeuge starten, die uns nach Stalingrad brachten. Aber in Stalingrad selbst gab es zwei Flughäfen noch, wo die deutschen Maschinen landen konnten. Pitomnik und Gumrak hießen die, glaube ich. Und einer von diesen beiden Flugzeugen wurde von den Russen überrannt. Es war nur noch eine Landemöglichkeit da. Und dadurch konnten wir auch nicht mehr eingeflogen werden.
In Stalingrad, the situation of the 6th Army had deteriorated rapidly throughout January. On the 8th, Paulus was offered terms for a surrender by the Russians. Hitler refused to capitulate. German troops were now collapsing from starvation and exhaustion. They were dying of exposure, and there were the first reports of widespread suicide.
So miserable were the German soldiers that suicide started to appear to be a welcome alternative to living in Stalingrad. And General Paulus had to specifically issue an order prohibiting suicide because he was concerned that his army would kill itself en masse and save the Soviets the job of doing it for him. Paulus's order did not stop suicide.
The German guns were now reduced to a ration of one shell per day to be fired only in emergencies. Even after the withdrawal of Army Group A, Hitler still refused to allow the suffering men to surrender. Crazed with hunger, they stubbornly continued to resist. With both airstrips now lost, the Luftwaffe was attempting to supply the men by parachute drops, which led to starving men being unable to reach the canisters which drifted into no man's land, or worse still, into the arms of their enemies. As the valiant men of the 6th Army were gradually pushed back into the ruins of Stalingrad itself, the German pocket was split by the Russians into two smaller pockets. The end was now plainly in sight. But Hitler could not accept that the superhuman efforts of the defenders were reaching a conclusion. On January the 30th, Hitler made Paulus a field marshal. No German field marshal since the unification of Germany had laid down his arms in the field, and the clear suggestion was that Paulus should either commit suicide or fight to the last. In fact, he did neither. The following day, January the 31st, 1943, Paulus surrendered. With him were 90,000 emaciated, disease-ridden men who shuffled like zombies into Russian captivity. Only 5,000 would survive to see Germany again.
I think this is one of the most heartbreaking episodes of the whole battle. Once the Germans have laid down their arms and become prisoners, these half-starved scarecrows are then subjected to inhuman and barbarous treatment. 90,000 people are taken into captivity, and only 5,000 ever emerge to see Germany again, some of them as many as 13 or 14 years later. Now, they were fighting for a regime which was vile and inhuman itself, but their captors were equally part of an implacable, a hostile, and a vicious regime in the form of Stalin's Red Army. And for the ordinary men and women who are caught in the middle of these appalling forces, you can only see cruelty and inhumanity. And I think that final chapter for me is the final irony. Even after the surrender, when they've been promised fair treatment, the Russians are going to break their promise, and everything is going to descend even further into more inhumanity for the next 13 years. It really is a terrible end to a terrible battle.
With superhuman effort, the remnants of the garrison pocket around the tractor works continued to resist until February the 2nd, but eventually even they had to lay down their arms. One survivor who would certainly see Germany again was to be Friedrich Paulus. He defected to the Soviet cause in captivity and began to work on behalf of the Free Germany Group, a Russian-sponsored attempt to undermine the fighting spirit of the German army. Even today, their attempts are remembered with scorn by those who were also held prisoner by the Russians.
Dass diese Leute ihre Strafe, würde ich ruhig mal sagen, hinterher bekamen. Denn als der Krieg dann zu Ende war und wir alle in Gefangenschaft kamen, dann kannte der Russe plötzlich diese angeblichen Überläufe oder was nicht mehr. Dann hieß es plötzlich, ihr alles, wie er immer sagt, ein paar Worte Deutsch konnten die ja inzwischen dann auch, ihr alles deutsche Schweine. Auch diese Leute, die uns dann zum Überlaufen oder was zwingen oder beraten wollten, die gingen dann auch denselben Weg, den wir gingen und harrten auch die 4, 5 oder 6 Jahre in Sibirien aus. Gut, ich will nicht sagen, vielleicht eine kleine Strafe dafür. Ich halte von solchen Leuten nicht ganz viel, denn Kameraden verraten ist, glaube ich, das Schlimmste, was man hier machen kann auf der Welt, ne?
Despite the best efforts of the Nazi propaganda machine to lionize the defenders of Stalingrad with cartoon images of heroism like these from the pages of the Wehrmacht's own magazine, the magnitude of the disaster was plain for all to see. 300,000 sons, husbands and brothers had been lost, and every town and village in Germany felt their loss. Quite literally, putting a brave face on announcing the disaster at Stalingrad to the surviving German forces in the east, the High Command ordered that the officers in the field read out the last message received by shortwave radio from the ruins of the tractor factory during the last days of the fighting. It read,
"We are the last survivors in this place. 4 of us are wounded. We have been entrenched in the wreckage of the tractor factory for 4 days. We have not had food for 4 days. I have just opened the last magazine for my automatic. In 10 minutes, the Bolsheviks will overrun us. Tell my father that I have done my duty and that I shall know how to die. Long live Germany. Heil Hitler."
I think the paradox about the Battle of Stalingrad is this, that neither side expected to fight it. The Germans didn't, and the Russians didn't. On the part of Hitler and Stalin, the Battle of Stalingrad became a test of will, it became a test of commitment, it became a test of capability, it became a political signal. And in the attempt to reduce Stalingrad, the city itself, then of course Sixth Army got drawn closer and closer into the city itself.